evening, everybody. Welcome to the May 4th meeting of the Select Board. I'm going to call the meeting to order at 7 o'clock. And just a couple of mainly housekeeping items. Just want to talk a little bit about some changes you may notice in the Select Board agenda going forward. First of all, there has been some discussion about public comment period. And from now on, to the extent that there is a question that can be easily asked and answered coming from the floor during the public comment period, we will in fact attempt to answer that. Just a reminder that during public comment, the reason that the rules generally state that the Select Board should not respond, or actually anybody should not be responding during public comment, is to avoid any sort of deliberation or dialogue about a topic that was not on the agenda. So, but to you know, again, promote transparency and be as cooperative as possible, we will try to answer any simple questions that arise during that time frame. Another change that we're implementing is from now on, the agenda will have a town administrator update. So for items kind of falling outside the normal scope of business, major projects that are going on, David Nixon will be providing us with a regular update at our Select Board meetings so that folks can stay apprised of the progress in that regard. Just wanted to mention that. The last item that we're going to do is from now on to try to keep better track of any action items arising during the Select Board meeting. So to the extent there is a to-do or a task coming out of our discussions during the evening, Jennifer is graciously going to keep track of those to make sure that we don't drop any of those items, again, in the spirit of providing good customer service. Okay. So with that said, I'd like to open the public comment period. Is there anybody here this evening who would like to make public comment? Mr. Allen?
I'd like the Select Board to consider making a clear statement as to the town's financial condition before the vote tomorrow. My thinking is that the voters tomorrow at the town meeting should have the context in which they vote the budget. Mm-hmm. And I guess it's generally known that the budget is $140,000 shy. But it's also generally known that in order to be only $140,000 shy, if I could put it that way, the town has pushed off hundreds of thousands of dollars of expense to the fall, hoping that there'll be additional revenue to cover that. But the revenue that's reported as possibly being available is really murky and suspect by an awful lot of people. So I would like the board to comment on that if you feel it's appropriate.
I believe we are planning on making some general opening remarks tomorrow night to help frame that conversation, so certainly take that into consideration.
What I meant was tonight, so that the word can get around the town, not after they arrive.
Okay. We can probably talk about that when we get to the warrant articles. Okay.
Thank you.
Sure. And David, actually, can I ask, is the Finance Committee planning on making any comments in advance of the budget article?
Right, they're meeting at 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock tomorrow, and they will be putting together some comments for those for the budget presentation.
Okay. Mr. Michkowski?
Yeah, to inform the board, we talked about that medical marijuana site, and the moss is within the perimeter of that, and it may be rejected on our part. So anything to do with children, there's a certain distance from the dispensary to them, and that falls within it. Mm-hmm. So if so, we talked to Pioneer Planning Commission agent yesterday, and he said that he thinks that that's not allowed in there.
Okay, and when you say we, just for people at home, you're referring to the planning board?
Right, at the planning board's meeting, we had a discussion. We met with Pioneer Valley Planning Commission. So, and then I also, about that same category. I talked to the Ethics Commission today about serving it, and I think from now on, when you appoint a task force or any other kind of subcommittee, you specify why you're doing it, what the purpose and who they represent. And I did ask you for your comment that you said I was in conflict, and you said you're not going to give it to me. Had I had that, I would have sent it along, emailed it to the Ethics Commission, and then they would have ruled on that. If you make a statement like that, you should be willing to back it up. You know, if you believe it's right, I believe it wasn't right. But until they see that, then they could send a ruling. But I think you said that you want to go to town council, and I don't want to see no expense brought onto the town by the expense of town council. So in the future, I hope you guys set that policy that everything's explained.
For a task force
and subcommittee. Because I was elected official, and I wanted to serve on a committee gathering information. And she actually told me she sees absolutely nothing wrong with that, but you had a problem with that. And, you know, like I said, just to say you're in conflict is not enough. It's the reason. But you wouldn't give me that reason.
Okay. Yeah, so going forward, we can talk about having a policy on the formation of subcommittees and task force.
Just a point of interest. When we're setting our agenda, are we following the same policy where they have to meet with you and David on Friday again to get on the agenda, or has that changed in any way?
I'm sorry, who has to meet with me and David?
That's what I understood has to happen when you set the agenda. Am I wrong? That's what I was told when I had to meet with you and the chairman.
Well, the chair sets the agenda.
And this is on Friday usually, right? It's been.
Usually Thursday, Friday, depending upon our schedules.
Okay, and so that's going to remain the same?
Yeah, I mean...
Because if somebody comes in here to ask to be on the agenda with some pertinent information, the way I understand it, the board tells them next you have to go in on Friday to meet with the chair to see if you'll be placed on the agenda a second time.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, they really just need to contact me. I don't know that there has to be a formal meeting. There may be circumstances that might warrant an in-person meeting, but as long as the contact is made with either me or with the town administrator, then we'll determine whether or not it makes sense to put it on the agenda.
I think we have to do anything humanly possible to make this much friendlier to people to come in. They're only allowing us to sit in these chairs for them, the voters. And when they have to come in and get grilled about getting on the agenda, I don't think it's right. I think we should simplify the process and try to get them on the agenda as quick as possible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then just one other comment since the topic of agendas came up. You know, the chair certainly will work with the town administrator to set the agenda, but anybody on the select board should feel free if there are issues that you want to see on an agenda as well. This is the agenda for the group, not...
Well, exactly. We never isolated it, you know, to Fridays. It legally has to be posted 48 hours before the meeting.
It's the purview of the chair, depending on what their flexibility is.
Because we still want
Guilford
to make sure
may have had a different flexibility because he was available on Fridays.
Yes.
Molly has a different flexibility because she's available at other times.
Mm-hmm.
There's no policy regarding it. It's the purview of the chair.
Yeah,
and certainly as we go along, if it's not working for anybody, just let me know. We'll adjust.
Fine, thank you.
Okay, public comment period. So just because we've had a couple of people who've already spoken, is there anybody else who wants to speak during public comment period before I go back to the well? No? Okay, John, you both have your hands up, but John, did you?
Yeah, you mentioned the administrator's report, and it caused me to think, what is the format of that? In many towns, it's a written report, it's a weekly, here's what I did for the week, and it appears in board docs ahead of time so that you or the public could ask about some of the things that appear. But to be effective, it can't just be verbal. It's got to be promulgated ahead of time so people can think about it and ask questions.
Okay.
Is that your plan?
We're going to try this, so it's something new. So we're going to try it a couple of different ways and see what works best. So certainly that's a valid comment. John?
I'd like to make some kind of a complaint to you folks. I went back from 2009 to do some research, and your selectmen's meeting, and they didn't coincide of what happened to town meeting on the warrant. And then I said to myself, well, it's gonna be, because you always have discussion before a town meeting, and there was nothing in that for that particular article. It was Article 12 that was passed over. I couldn't find where there was any talk of the selectmen, so I said, I'm gonna go see the videotapes. Well, lo and behold, all the videotapes were destroyed. I hope for litigation purpose, it can help you or it can break you. But that to me is, every word that's said here is recorded on that, and that should be held for the duration, not just turn around, because there was no paper shifted by the supervisor of public records that authorized disposal of public records. There was that I couldn't find, so.
Don't we have a policy that the board adopted sort of a year or two ago now on the recording?
Yeah, I remember that there was a time when we that we learned that the digital tapes were being reused and effectively erased, and so we asked that that practice to cease, and that we keep a copy, the permanent record of any public body meeting are the minutes once they've been approved. So any device used in order to record those proceedings can be erased or reused or thrown away at that time. That's perfectly legal. But the importance of the select board and the ease of storage these days in electronic format really speaks to we should be keeping these records for the long term.
Okay, and could we get a copy of the policy that was adopted to Mr. Michkowski?
I think that was in a form of an email from me to HPAT.
Okay. Could you, yep.
Just for the record, everything, all meeting DVDs are now kept in perpetuity.
Okay.
Never thrown away.
As of when? When did that start?
2012.
2012,
yeah. Okay.
We voted on that.
Yeah, that's what
we
I
had
remember.
This little incident.
But what was missing there, as Mr. Nixon says, that's the record, the minutes. But the minutes doesn't talk about what is actually talked there. It's only the motions, and that's it. And when you want to find out the detail of something, you got to look at that tape, because nobody's going to put word for word what's in that tape. That tape is the important key, you know, like I said, for any, if there's future litigation or something that needs to protect the board, you need to keep that.
Okay. Anything else? Okay, if not, we'll close public comment. And the next agenda item is the consent agenda. So we have three items on the consent agenda. We have the minutes from April 27th. We have warrants, payroll 1644. And then we also have an item, which is the appointment to a local hazardous mitigation plan review committee. David, would you mind just speaking to that?
Certainly, and the fire chief is here to speak to that as well. We have a local hazard mitigation plan, which has to be updated from time to time. We need a pit. It's time for us to review that again, in order to make sure that the town is prepared for any kind of natural hazard that may occur. That committee for the review and upgrade, the fire chief has suggested myself, David Nixon, town administrator, himself, Michael Spanknebel, fire chief and emergency management director, Michael Mason, chief of police, Marla Warner, DPW director, Michael Klimoski, Highway and Water Superintendent, Dennis Paczynski, Wastewater Superintendent, Richard Tessier, Board of Health, Jen Gould, Board of Health, Ann McKenzie, Superintendent of Schools, Suzanne Travisano, Senior Services Director, and John Michkowski, Senior on the Planning Board.
Okay. I'll
make a motion to accept the minutes, the warrants, and the Local Hazardous Mitigation Review Committee.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Wait a minute. So what, is this part of the original hazmat coordination?
This isn't hazardous material, it's the local hazard mitigation program, so in order for you to apply for hazard mitigation funding that comes out annually for culverts that are in disrepair and things like that, with risk analysis, cost benefit analysis, all that stuff, that's what the purpose of this is. It was done originally, we started the plan in 2010, it was adopted in 2011, and you do a refresher review of it. The draft came out in November, it's being done through grant funding under the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission. So we have 5 meetings, which includes 2 public hearings, and the previous group, most of the folks are no longer here with us, so we added in some spaces for those departments, and we'll be going through the plan to make any updates and anything that's been corrected or improved upon.
All right, so put it to a vote, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Abstain.
You're abstaining, okay. All right, then next item on the agenda is the town administrator's report.
Okay, thank you very much for the opportunity. At this time of year, with the town meeting just around the corner, it's all town meeting all the time. So I'm looking forward to next week when we can return to some of the projects that we have in process, and those include the IT upgrade project, which we've made the formal order for, the classification compensation plan, as well as a whole host of procurement that needs to get done. Just to touch on a couple of projects that we have in the works right now, Bay Road Bridge, everybody wants to know about that. We have a call into Mass DOT to find out what the latest is, in particular the process. According to the NOAA website, the probability of flooding along the Connecticut River starts dropping significantly after June 1st. So my interest is to find out what is the process by which Mass DOT pursues this project. Do they have to bid it out? Are they doing it in-house? That'll give us a good sense of how long this project is going to take and what's the delay between low water and the beginning of the project. Route 9 project, the Berkshire Gas Company is conducting their work to replace the gas main and the services along the project area. Their work takes about 40 days to complete. We're about a week into it. Their work pretty much goes before anybody else's. There's some survey work that can occur, as well as some site work that can occur. But until that gas main is and the service connections are completed, we're not going to see a whole lot of else going on. Internally, we have submitted the funding for the SRF application, and that has been turned over to the Department of Environmental Protection for the favorable interest rates on the loan. It will take them 40 days to process that that application. So we should not be acting on any invoices that we may receive for our part of that project until we receive the green light from DEP, but we should get that in the next 4 weeks or so. ETNL, that's the contractors, are moving forward with their work, and that we should start seeing their presence there more with signage and with other work along the project area. The project area, just in case anybody missed it, is from Wally Street to about where the Farm Museum is along Route 9. We talked about the Memorial Day Parade. We don't see a problem with that proceeding normally, so that should proceed, and we'll coordinate that with that project. So that's all we have at this point on that particular project. We had a department head meeting today where we talked about a number of things. First of all, we have a new finance team in place for the close of the fiscal year. So we talked about due dates for expenditures, revenues, encumbrances, final date for finance committee transfers, and the last warrant. And I can give you those dates if you wish. We also talked about revenue enhancement for FY 2017. All the departments have been asked to review their revenues, and in particular their schedules of costs for permits and any other kind of revenue that they may be in charge of, just to make sure that these are up to date and that the controls are in place to make sure that we're not losing any revenues. So they'll be reporting back to me in the next week or so about that. Finally, we talked about rumor control. We've had a number of unfounded rumors affecting the quality of our work and our productivity. So we talked about ways that department heads should manage information, particularly if it sounds like it's unfounded information, bringing that to either the liaison of the select board or to me as town administrator, as well as having the department heads manage their department members, make sure that they're in control of information so that we don't have distraction or delay or convulsion because somebody has said something which is not based upon fact. We have our capital plan, which needs to be updated, and I expect that we will start working on that with the departments starting June 1st and have that completed by the end of August in time for the special town meeting. Speaking of special town meeting, I've identified the date of October 20th as the date of the next town meeting, and I will work with the chair in order to come up with a calendar for action items along the way to make sure that we meet that target, and I'll bring that information back to not only the chair but the board as well. We have some bids. The clarifier bids came in over budget. We're going to get a recommendation to the board soon in order to come up with a game plan to move forward with that project. The HVAC control bid, we received no bids on that, so we will be rebidding that. And then tonight, the public safety complex roof will be authorized by the select board to go out to bid. And then finally, last but not least, we have the EPA has issued through the Massachusetts Department of Environmental Protection what's called the MS4 stormwater permit. This is a big deal, and Marla Warner and I are going to be receiving training on that next Monday. But this is going to have a big impact upon Hadley, so we'll come back with recommendations about that. But basically, in a nutshell, EPA has changed the rules by which we monitor and treat stormwater throughout town. We knew that this is coming for several years. It's affected 88 communities in the Charles River Basin. So it's come here finally. We've been expecting it for a while. So we'll come back with more details on that. So that's about it right now, except for town meeting is tomorrow at 7 o'clock in Hopkins Academy, and every registered voter is encouraged to attend.
Any questions for David on the contents of his report?
Just a quick one. The storm drainage is a federal mandate?
Yes.
And no money coming with it, or is there?
We don't expect to see any money, but we're going to explore that to make sure that we can get some, but I don't expect to see any financial support from the federal government for something like this. I think the most that the state can do for us is not to add on to the federal requirements, so that DEP has said, you know, we will at least not increase your burden that you're going to have to bear, but this will be an unfunded mandate.
The mandates with the state is at least being looked at by the Attorney General's office. Before anything can be mandated, they're trying to pass some legislation that they will study and see how it affects municipalities and cities and what cost burden they would have to take in this. So there's some protection. I hope that legislation gets passed, but it's just up in the air now, the talking stage, I think, right?
It will greatly improve things if we can get relief from unfunded mandates. It really will.
There are some municipalities who have actually taken a revenue approach to addressing the issue. Mm-hmm. Our neighbors in Northampton actually have adopted a tax, for I don't think they're calling it a tax, but whatever they're calling it, to cover the impact to the city.
I can tell you right now that a significant contributor to our stormwater is a state-owned property just to the east of us.
Oh, so we can tax the state. Nice.
It's collecting, that's the problem.
Collecting, right. Mr.
Michkowski? Yeah. About Mr. Nixon's report about unfounded rumors, I can testify for this. Last year, he accused me for unfounded rumors on Mount Warner pump station. Okay, he made all these statements. I went in there with permission from Mike Komoski and Dennis Pep, and that was when the other DPW came.
I'm sorry, John, is this relevant to
Yes, it is, because he wants to, don't shake your head, no, because he labeled me with unfounded, yet you folks spent $8,000 for those unfounded rumors. I listen to people what they say, and I follow it up all the time because it could lead into something that is serious. So he should not do that, and he did that. He put it in writing, and I got a copy of that.
Yeah. Well, if I can I can just take a minute and kind of clarify, because I was at the department head meeting, and Donald was as well, and I had an opportunity to talk to David a little bit after the meeting. When I first joined this, well, when Donna Moyer was our previous acting school superintendent, before Annie came on board, and one of the first things she suggested to the school committee was that she recognized that as elected officials, you know, our role truly is to have our ear to the community and represent the community interests. And as part of that role, there are going to be times where people come and they tell us things. And of course, we should always be doing everything we can to represent the residents and improve life here in Hadley, whatever that entails. But she said, I only ask you one thing. If people bring something to your attention, rather than setting, you know, town personnel off on what potentially may be a very valid issue, or it may be a wild goose chase, the first thing you want to do is ask whoever's reporting to you, are you willing to field a phone call from whoever it is that's going to be investigating or following up? To the extent somebody doesn't want to put their name to something, I would just encourage everybody to say, I'm sorry that there's not a lot we can do, unless you're willing to say, I'm concerned about this or whatever. So I would just add that to David's comments about it, and I think that will help go a long way, and again, just keeping us focused on getting things done in town.
Again, I'd like to thank you. Every time I've called you, you always return the call. The other selectmen have it. So you're doing a good job on that part.
That's why she's the chair.
And oftentimes I say a prayer before I hit that final number.
Is there any kind of estimate of what kind of financial impact this Tier 4 is going to have on us?
I don't want to spout numbers without any facts at this point, but I mean, it's going to be a significant impact upon the town.
I mean, with the budget restraints we're under right now, we need to, you know, somehow get some kind of rough number on this that we're going to need to plug into our budget.
I think that's why they're going Monday to figure that out.
Yes.
Also, another bit of information, David, I don't know if anybody knows, but the legislature has been working after this Flint thing, and I got it right here. The representatives are looking in with Congress on the infrastructure for water and wastewater. They met with 300 different cities, towns, governors, states. They're looking at $1.3 billion in wastewater funding and $1.3 billion in water funding to put into the local state SRF funds, revolving accounts for the towns and cities in the United States. So this Flint thing is really kind of exploded and got the big government involved. So,
but
there's a good article here. If anybody wants to read it, I can get it to you.
Could you forward that, John?
Yeah.
To help us?
Yeah. I was.
Or to Jennifer at least, and then she.
I was on my coffee break this morning reading this. So.
Okay. Thank you, John. Quickly.
Yes, I had the same question as Mr. Buskevich. What is the extra cost of the stormwater drainage? And I'm wondering if this wouldn't be a nice thing for Jennifer to, maybe the first thing for Jennifer to keep track of. If they go to the meeting on Monday, we should have an answer, as you suggest.
It's going to be the second thing, because she's going to get Johnny a copy of the policy.
Oh, the second thing, okay.
John, how many first meetings have you been to that you've got answers instead of more questions?
What's that?
And how many first meetings have you gone to that had more answers than questions?
Well, I'm not being critical of anyone. I'm just saying because given the tight budgets, if that's an extra added cost, you ought to have a real good estimate of that, and the finance committee ought to know about it. That's your plan.
Yeah, absolutely. No, it's a good point. Any further questions for David?
I think the one thing to be said about that is that this is going to be a fairly slow-moving train wreck in terms of the unfunded mandate. So we're not going to see any real costs for a while, but they will occur. There will be deadlines associated with these new requirements. It's not going to be like tomorrow, but it's not going to probably be at the beginning of next fiscal year.
Mm-hmm. But that's my point. You've got 5-year budget projections, and it's got to be plugged in because, and by the way, your budget projections are a couple of years behind where they should be.
Agreed. We're going to be working on it.
Thank you.
Yep. Anything else for David?
Is this the same avenue we're traveling as Northampton, where you have large amounts of impervious material on your property? You pay a little extra tax because it hasn't got an area to go into the ground, the lawn water.
As I said, a large portion of our stormwater comes from a state facility, and whatever kind of revenue enhancement we want to look at, it has to be fair and shouldn't be disproportionately on the private property. So we need to take a long look at that and make sure that if we're going to be charging additional money, and that's an if, we're going to be charging additional money, that it has to be fair and apportioned where it needs to go.
I guess what I'm getting to would, we have a large commercial district, and we have multitudes of areas with large parking lots.
Mm-hmm.
And they would be subject to additional tax because of this. This is what Northampton's doing right now. Mm-hmm. They're in the works to do this. Yeah. So we would be confronted with that with our commercial district, especially.
It's premature at this point. We simply don't know enough about this. And this has to be debated by the board and by the town.
Mm-hmm. So we'll want to explore, or at least understand what all of our options
right.
are, and that discussion.
Public comments, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably going to okay. have to be something that goes on town meeting floor anyway to be approved. So,
yeah. All right. Anything else for the contents of David's report? Otherwise, we'll move on to old business.
All right. A public record. Can they get a copy of that? His report.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay.
We got to grab it before that gets lost.
All right. The next. Next item of old business, Lake Warner Dam historic use restriction.
All right, so as we all know, Lake Warner Dam is owned by Kestrel Land Trust, and they're partnering with the Friends of Lake Warner. They received a state grant of $100,000, $125,000 from the state, and they also received $100,000 from CPA money. And as part of that project, we need to sign several documents, one of which is the historic preservation restriction, making sure that that's an easy one because it's going to remain a dam. It always has been a dam. It's not always going to be a dam. They're not going to renovate it and make it into something else, like a Starbucks or something like that. So that's an easy document for us to sign, but that's required by law. The other is we need to sign a grant agreement to transfer the money from the CPA to the Kestrel Trust. The Kestrel Trust did go out to bid on this project. All the bids came in very high, so they are now taking a look at what their options are. So if we could get these documents out of the way, that'll help them regroup and get their feet under them and come at this project from a different angle.
Okay. Any questions or comment?
Yeah, you're asking us to commit to something where they're actually coming, the bids are coming in high for $100,000. Wouldn't we wait until they had a final number so we could decide whether or not?
This is not a commitment on part of the town. This is their commitment to us that they're going to if they access
historic
the money,
preservation.
The historic preservation, that they're not going to change the essential purpose of the dam, other than to repair and renovate it.
Okay.
and just to transfer the money when they need it from CPA. And there is a sunset provision on that CPA money of December 31st, 2016.
I don't want to spend any money if the project doesn't get completed.
We're not committing money, we're not spending money, we're simply allowing them to access it.
But we have a deadline in December, so.
You want to think about this for a bit?
If they're accessing, how is it not being spent?
If you want to think about it, that's fine.
No, I'm asking a question. If they're accessing the money, doesn't that mean it's being spent?
No, what we're doing is we're signing a grant agreement by which the money can be transferred if they're going to access it.
It won't be transferred.
I don't have a problem with that. I just want to make sure that we're not funding something and half the project gets done and our $100,000 gets spent and we have half a project done.
We're not giving them the money. All we're doing is we're laying the legal foundation by which the project can move forward.
I have no problem with voting on that.
Additionally, we're not putting any additional restrictions on this. Say, like in the future, if we wanted to put a hydro plant there, would this restriction that we're voting on tonight restrict us from being able to do that in the future?
I think that would be a call made by the Historic Commission, actually, to tell you the truth, because they're co-signers to the historic preservation restriction.
Because we went to the meeting the other night, it was like a two-hour presentation, and Congregational Church, it was really well prepared, and they even said things in the future they would like to put a hydro plant there to offset, to start the cleaning of Lake Warner using the monies from the hydro plant. So I don't want to sign anything that's going to be so restrictive you can't do that.
Well, it's not ours to put the to do that. We're only saying it's historical. The owners of that bridge is the Kessel Trust, not us.
I assume they'd have to come before the town to put that on anyways.
We don't own it.
I don't know. There's people here from the historicals. Do you have any information how it would be affected possibly?
Restriction? No, that hasn't come to us yet.
Okay. It seems like, I mean, just my opinion, it seems like there are a couple of questions that have been raised that are worthy of further investigation. So, I mean, I'd be inclined not to take a vote tonight, move it to a subsequent agenda and get some of these questions answered. Is there any pressing timeline, David, from Kestrel's standpoint? I mean, can they wait another week or two?
I think they can wait another week or two because they have to figure out what to do with their bid results.
Okay. How would everybody feel about that, waiting and getting Donald's and Jerry's questions answered?
Maybe we could send out a request to have the executive director of Friends of Lake Warner appear before us. He has all that pertinent information, seeing we gave grants for him to do these studies and everything. And
sure, yeah.
He could answer a lot of my questions, I know.
Who's that, Donald?
That would be good.
Donald, who's that?
Mary, what is his name?
Jason Johnson.
Oh, okay.
It's actually Kristen DeBoer is the executive director.
She's from Kestrel, but Donald's talking about
the Friends of Lake Warner.
Oh, I see.
He's the executive director.
Yes, yeah, Jason Johnson, you're right.
Right. But certainly Kristen's
maybe you could get them both here.
Yeah.
Do we have any other questions than the two that were raised? I mean, couldn't we do this without dragging them here? Do you have any other questions regarding it? I just want to know. The money's
if we're
be
just
spent
moving the money, I have no problem with it. It doesn't affect anything else. You know, there's not a problem.
And
but
whether
if there's other restrictions, I get nervous. Yeah.
All right, so let's hold off on that until we have additional information for the board. Okay, everybody okay with that? Then we're going to move on to the next agenda item, which is North Hadley Village Hall. And I believe we have a relatively brief presentation, relatively, for Mr. Michkowski this evening. David, do you have anything to say or just let
him? Mr. Michkowski has missed the floor.
This is about you, so put your foot over here. All right. The North Hadley Hall right here, church here. I went to Randy Iser that surveyed this property, and I asked him, I said, what is the biggest building that we could use for poles or substation for the fire department? So he drew a line here. He drew a line first I think it was here, to make this conforming lot and this non-conforming that looks like 1,700 square foot, build a real small section. And then I said, well, what's the largest lot we could put if we made them both non-conforming? Either way, they would have to go in front of the ZBA. And because this is for municipal use, there should be actually no problem with the ZBA supporting a town venture. What this plan would do was it allow access to the pond right here. If you guys sold this, you would close that access off. So this, from this point to this point is all lakefront frontage right here. First Randy drew it, the Rivers Act came in here, but this doesn't fall in the Rivers Act. It falls, the Rivers Act falls at the base of the dam. This falls within the Wetlands Act, which is a 35 foot setback. So what he suggested, that this could be done here, a parking here, this area here would be restricted for personnel use in a tow zone. If say someone parked in here, they would tow that away. So volunteer fire department or full-time department in the future would come in here, park here, exit this way. There'd be a lock and light here, red light here and there. Would make the village safety, for safety for the cars to stop. Apparatus could exit, apparatus could recharge that, lights coming back in and driving here and back at the station safely. And again, this would have access to here with passive recreation, a possible area here for the church for their services Saturday and Sunday. And I certainly would, and what I'm looking into is, I know I went to a village meeting, I don't know, was it last year or whatever, and I brought up about, I really support over 55 housing. And to even explore that, if we could use CPA funding for that, pledge a bond, and possibly go for a historical grant. But if it is not restricted for Hadley residents, I certainly wouldn't want to be involved in it anyways. I feel there's no place really that's affordable for our Hadley people. This could probably be 8 to 10 units. And I've talked to this guy, in a historical preservation specialist today, and he says you could reserve for Hadley residents even if you use state or federal money. So it would be set through the housing authority, and of course for 8 units there'd be a long list of Hadley residents waiting for it. So I think it's really a viable plan, and it'll fit. This would be a colonial type fire station in here. It would fit in the village. And there's also, I looked into state and federal law that this building could be demolished. And David went and picked up copies for me today. So that's another option. But before this is gone through, I think they should go to a town meeting for discussion. Maybe we can get some estimates on a building here. And if the folks want to keep this, they want to get rid of this, this thing could be out in the middle of this lot. It could be a really attractive looking thing, and open this up for the lake, for the church to use, and it would fit really nice in the village. So, I hope you guys would not sell that land, but give the opportunity to do some more study. The planning board last night voted 4-0, Joseph Zagranek being out. It went through the historic commission. They think it's worthy of going through. And the building committee, they would like to take a look at it. Is that right, the way you voted it?
We didn't vote. What we said was we followed the recommendation of the historical commission. As with any board, the more options that we have to present to the residents, we certainly support that. But there are issues, certainly, shoehorning the station there.
Okay. And just to put this in context too, just kind of bring everybody back to two weeks ago when we met, there was an RFP that was sent out to find out who might be interested in purchasing North Hadley Village Hall based on the prior year's vote from town meeting. We did receive two bids, one from Joel Greenbaum, the other from the North Hadley Congregational Church. The subcommittee met and in order of ranking, ranked Joel Greenbaum's proposal first for a price tag of $72,000, and then the North Hadley Congregational Church second. So there was sufficient inquiries being made about whether or not, given the relatively low bid price of $72,000, whether or not the town should take another look at this under the theory that perhaps the land in and of itself is more valuable than the bid that came in. So that's what brings us here to this conversation tonight. And Mr. Michkowski had asked for audience to make another proposal.
Was the original RFQ, did that include the field that Mr. Michkowski is talking, include the whole land?
So the RFP included a lot of people, four options. One was to take the entire property, others were to take portions of the property. Okay. So it was not entirely clear whether presenters wanted the entire property. North Hadley Congregational Church did. It sounded like Mr. Greenbaum was more open for negotiation on that score.
So from the select board standpoint then, just to kind of cover the range of options we have in front of us, we could move to, whether it's tonight or another night, to formally accept one of the bids that are in front of us. We could reject both bids. We could go back out to bid, I'm assuming, would be another option. Or we could take additional time to explore, alternative scenarios, if you will. Does that cover everything?
Pretty much.
Okay. With that, then, conversation up here.
I guess a point of interest again, about 3 weeks ago, the Planning Commission had viewing at Hopkins Academy. They had 200 chairs set up, and it was a shame only four people went to see this presentation. It was about the Route 47 byway, and presently they're not funding any more byways in this country, but the byways that are existing, there's a lot of money out there to progress with them. And Chris Curtis from the Planning Commission said there are monies available to create a park along the byway, which if land is left in the back, like Mr. Michkowski said, it would be an ideal place for a small park and still have access to the lake for the future. Once we get rid of all that land, the town will never have it again or a chance to access the lake. So that's something we have to consider.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Danica?
Which proposal did Greenbaum give us a price on? Project number one, number two, number three, or number four? Because I know they came out with some, with just the building and a couple of feet, the building and a little more land than the building and the whole piece. So did he bid on just the building or part one, two, three, and four?
Yeah.
It was not entirely clear,
what
his bid for $72,000 covers. They didn't quite spell it out in the way that you're asking that question.
I think it would be very smart to have spelled it out. Are we selling the lot, which is worth over $100,000-something, mm-hmm. and the building, okay, $72,000 if you're only getting the building. Mm-hmm. But if you're buying the land with the building, well, that's over the money.
Exactly. Yep. The assessed value of the whole property is over $400,000. It makes absolutely no sense at all, not to me. I wouldn't sell that piece of property if it was mine for $72,000. If it was a fairly reasonable offer, it would be something to entertain. But this is, you know, no matter what restrictions we had put on it, or historic has put on it, I just think both of these figures are just outrageously too low and out of contents.
Just me?
What will it cost the town to, if you put out for a new proposal, what will it cost the town to keep that building safe until something happens with it?
You mean keep it from falling under further disrepair?
Yes.
So you have, the municipal building committee has $94,000 that can be applied to any building for any repair on any building. Certainly, we're not talking about upgrading that building for $94,000, but that certainly would, correct me if I'm wrong, but that certainly would take care of minor repairs in order
just
to keep it together.
Are you talking about repairs or just keep it open?
Not even keep it open.
Just off the
roof leaking.
Right.
The roof is in serious disrepair.
It is.
Yes. We've been very lucky so far that the leaks are extremely minimal at this point. The unfortunately, what happens is the tile that's up there, when the winds come, they actually pick up, and when we have driving rain, the rains do go underneath the tile. So there's a lot of loose areas in there. We have done some repairs, but it is in very tough shape right now. Mm-hmm. And, you know, certainly me as an inspector, I have closed it down for issues, serious issues. And that's going to get very problematic quickly with regard to what we
To your point, you want to take into account the carrying
costs. The carrying costs,
right.
And also the fact that if the town doesn't own it, but it's sold to a private individual, mm-hmm. it will then go back on the tax rolls, correct?
Yes.
At something at the rate of 400 and whatever it's currently assessed for, and then as it's mm-hmm. improved, it will bring in more income. Mm-hmm.
Which is exactly what the town of Sunderland did when they sold the town hall that was in the center of town for a dollar. And I know a lot of the taxpayers thought that that was an absolute ridiculous sum. But it allowed the investors to put the Blue Heron restaurant there, and is now a very vibrant part of the center of town, and it's a huge taxpayer for the town of Sunderland. So you need to weigh some of those things. It may be valued at $400,000, but I think if we were to all take a real tough look at it, we'd say that anybody that's going to buy that piece of property is going to have to make a miraculous investment in it to turn it into something that I think the people in North Hadley would be proud to have in their neighborhood.
Just
I
the
also
property
think
it sits on, Jerry, is worth over $150,000.
We put it out to bid, John. What people came in and it, you can say whatever it's worth, but what people bid on you is what it's worth, not what we think
the
it
town.
Is. Where were the bidders?
An acre of property. Then I'm fine. I'm not going to accept either one of these offers.
I understand.
In my opinion, and whether we go out to bid or look at another option, then we'll be at that point after a vote. I think we should put it through a vote and see where everybody stands on it right
well,
now.
Well, I'd like to remind you all that at town meeting 2 years ago, we voted to sell the piece of property, mm-hmm. and that was the will of the town meeting vote. Mm-hmm. And that was to sell the North Hadley Hall. So, you know, my thoughts on this is that we cannot afford as a town to do an upkeep on this building, to do a renovation on this building at prevailing wages. It would devastate us to have to do anything to that building to make it habitable. So to me, selling that piece of building would be the smartest thing to do. And I did mention before myself, when we started all of this, about using that piece of property for a fire station. I'm willing to explore that part of it, but I'm not willing to have the town put another penny into that North Hadley Hall. That it was voted on to sell it, we should sell it, let somebody rehab it and do what's best for the town and for the North Hadley Village and put it into a nice property.
And I agree with Joyce. I think that, you know, I have no appetite, and I want to respect the will of town meeting to sell North Hadley Hall. But I am questioning the, whether or not, you know, the access issues to Lake Warner, the feasibility of us retaining the land, especially given the fact that Mr. Greenbaum did seem to have some degree of flexibility on that. It seems like we should spend more time exploring that before we make a final decision on the land itself. Mr. Allen?
There's been some excellent suggestions here, and they lead me to believe that more discussion will be in order. And it should be really easy to do tonight for the Board of Selectmen to say, we're not even sure what the guy who did $72,000 was buying.
Yeah.
So let's defer until we find that out, and then bring up some of these excellent suggestions.
It's also important to remember that we do consider all alternatives that are available to us.
That's right. Marcus?
Speaking for the Historical Commission, we would hope you would defer your decision, because I just think we have to realize the value of historic land, and it's easy to think of costs, but look long-term at the value of it. And I think there's so many questions to be answered that you need to publicly get all the questions and answer them and look at all the alternatives. For example, the one bid that was rated highest is asking for 10 apartments. That's not allowed by our zoning bylaws. Mm-hmm. So if that's not allowed, then what is the person going to do with the building?
And they would have to go before the ZBA. They could get a variance for that.
Well, we're saying they could get a variance, and I have a problem with that, because I think our planning board has worked so hard over almost 50 years in making zoning bylaws, and it's done a wonderful job. It's had Hadley remain a small community with lots of agriculture, and without those bylaws, we would be a bedroom community for Amherst with lots and lots of apartment buildings, and that would be it. We would have lost our character. And so to keep saying with the zoning bylaws, well, let's get a variance, I think that needs to be discussed and thought about. Do we keep wanting to get variances so we have more and more apartment buildings? I think there's too many questions to make a simple decision with the two offers.
The one thing we have to do, though, is to quit dragging our feet on this issue. I hear it time and time again how we've been dragging our feet and we need to make a decision on this. I absolutely hear what you're saying tonight, and I think you're 100% right. But we have to stop dragging our feet on this. And we're not going to have an ideal. I think last night at the Buildings Committee meeting, they said, ideally, we'd like for it to be something, but unless bidders come and bid on it that way, then it doesn't become that. So we have two bids that are in front of us. One of them is for somebody who's very vested in your neighborhood already in multifamily houses, and he does a very nice job, and that's a wonderful thing. And he's preserving some of the green space, which allows everybody to continue to enjoy it. So that was a positive thing that was discussed last night. The bidder is going to have the opportunity, whether we want to or not, to go for a variance. If they get it, they get it. If they don't, they don't. That certainly is within their purview. And I think, Timmy, you said that the building currently is a commercial building, commercial rated building.
That's correct.
So if you bought that and wanted to turn it into a commercial establishment, he's already zoned for that,
he
correct?
He can't. It's limited business.
Correct.
It's limited
business. It's a
correct.
Big difference.
Yeah.
Well, there's what the confusion has been is there's been some discussion that it can go for a conversion from a single family to a two family. That's not what our bylaw says. It specifically says that a single family residence that was built prior to 1961 can be converted to a two-family. That's not a single-family home, so it doesn't fit that criteria. So what you have to look at is what can be done with that building under our current zoning. All of it really goes under a special permit process through the planning board. But the other thing is that we really have to look at what the villagers have stated. They don't want a restaurant there. They don't want traffic there. There's a lot of things that they don't want. So they want things that don't have a lot of traffic. So what is there left? And it is a hard decision that we're going to be faced with. We have a building that's very large. It's over 11,000 square feet. So it doesn't even come close to any of our zoning for any other use than what it is right now municipal. We cannot afford the building. So like the board has said, we entertained selling it. We got that vote for it. But anything and everything will have to get a variance. So what do you do with it? How can anybody use a building that's over 11,000 square feet that doesn't have a lot of traffic? So we have one person that came in that is a very good steward of buildings, especially up in that area. Yeah, he's saying 8 apartments, high-end apartments, one bedroom, because one of the things that was stated from a lot of people is we don't want a lot of students. Where do the students come from? Students come, and we have problems with students when we have student stuffers, when we have a house with multiple bedrooms. So he's listened to everybody in this town. He was at those meetings, and he said, I think the only thing that's viable, remember, he's going to have to put in almost $2 million to do anything to this building. We would be putting in much, much more to just to fix it up, let alone not use it. So, I mean, yeah, it's a hard choice. No, unless we have deep pockets, we're stuck. What we got, it's a hard reality that we're faced with.
Again, I think it's very important to the folks that live around that village, and I think everybody in town's got to respect that. And we were there back when the village had a meeting there, the planning board, and I was there, and they seemed to like the over 55 housing in there. But I know the planning board would fight, and we would never issue a permit for single apartments in it. And to Joyce Chungwell's comment, we got town meeting approval. You got an approval, but such a big thing like this should be all remanded back to the town meeting, because you didn't tell them that at that time when you got approval, well, what's the price tag we could sell this for? If that was said, probably the people would say, don't sell it. Look to alternative uses of it or ways of either fixing it. If the price is totally outrageous, then maybe it has to come down. If they could get money from the Historic Society or with someone else too to help out, that's maybe an option. But I don't think that ever was explored. So
I've had more people come up to me over the last 2 years and say, get rid of it. You know.
Did you tell them how much you were offered, Joyce?
They didn't care, John. They did not want to have to put any more money into that building as a town. They didn't feel there are a lot of people in town that do not want to put money into that building.
Always remember this. They don't make any new land again.
That's
take
right.
Take care of your land you have.
Well, we can keep the land on the side of it, if that's the case.
There's my
option. I'm saying that we do not need, as a town, to be keeper of another building. We have enough building in towns that we can't take care of, and we need to get rid of them.
But
and that's the general feeling of the public.
Okay.
Not mine personally.
Back to my same question.
Just again, on behalf of the Historical Commission, I thank the committee.
Could you speak louder?
I'm sorry. To please postpone this decision, but I also want to reiterate something that was said by the board here, that Mr. Greenbaum's bid, although it has its virtues, it's not clear exactly what he was bidding on specifically to do with the land. And I just want to reiterate how important that is. I think that needs to be clarified before you can move forward, please. Jeff?
Yeah, back to my same question. We can't afford the buildings we got to maintain them. How are we going to afford a $6 million library and senior center? How are we going to afford a $4 million police and fire station upgrade for full time? How are we going to afford all these new things? if we can't maintain the old stuff. It doesn't add up.
So do we want to...
We can't balance our budget. We haven't balanced our budget in 4 years.
Do we want to actually take a vote tonight, or would the board prefer to do more fact-finding?
I'd like to make a motion that we do more fact-finding on this. I'm sorry, Margaret, did I interrupt you?
I just wanted to back up what John said. I think also with choosing between restoring the buildings we have and building new, we have to factor in the source of money that it costs for both things, and their CPA funding if you restore and renovate. There are state and federal grants you can go after to help with that. If it's new, then it all comes off to the tax dollar. And I think we need that kind of information as you make decisions to see the difference and cost and what part of it comes back to the,
you know, it
the
just,
taxes.
Yeah, the way we went about it was all wrong. Yes, we're going to sell North Hadley Hall. Well, now you're sending the fire department down the street and the park and rec. You know, we still don't have a place for them. Now, if we can't afford to pay the oil bill in that building, how the hell you think we're going to expect to pay rent for those two operations?
So I think there's a motion on the floor. Mr. Devine made a motion on the floor. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, second on the...
Still in the discussion phase, or are we making the votes?
No, we're just seconding the motion for discussion.
Okay.
Okay, so there's a motion made and seconded. Board first.
Okay. I'm inclined to agree with Mr. Neihardt. The building is a big liability for the town. I live across the street from it. It has a lot of historical value to me, going there to school, being a volunteer fireman there, going to religious church classes there, and the church itself. But it is a liability. We need a lot of repair. I remember the committee that remodeled it, my wife was on it, Margaret was on it, to make it historical, and a lot of money was spent by the town years ago to de-let it too. But today it isn't the building it once was. My main concern is preserving the land for the town. My other concern is with the building itself. Are there any contingencies that are going to be, if we sell it to Mr. Greenbaum, is there contingency saying he will get these permits? If he doesn't, he's not going to own the building. It's going to go back to the town. That's what I'm a little afraid of. It's easy to say sell it, but what are the contingencies that goes along with the sale?
It's a copy of the bidder's historical restrictions that went out with the bid, right?
That's right. And the building was also advertised as is with the historic restrictions.
But it's much more than that, as Mr. Neihardt was emphasizing, the permit process. If he doesn't get the permits, he can't do anything with the building himself.
This isn't the first building he's ever rehabbed as a historical building. So I'm sure he knows, in bidding on a building, he knows exactly what he's going in for. Because this isn't his first building.
I realize that. I live in the neighborhood. There's eight houses right around where I live.
He just doesn't own houses in your neighborhood.
He owns 179 houses in Amherst and Hadley that he rents. I'm not yelling. I'm giving information. I apologize.
I understand that. I'm telling you that this is not his first, and that he knows what zoning processes he has to go through.
And I guess I'm telling you, your attitude, if we just got to sell this, I don't go along with that either.
Okay. Everybody's got a right to their opinion. Mr. Allen?
Now, you have a motion and a second.
Yeah.
It seems very clear to me, sitting here in the audience, that this is not an issue you guys can resolve tonight.
Well, what'd you raise your hand for? We couldn't put it to a vote. All right.
Well, I guess, oh, excuse me, then you're going to put it to a vote right now?
Yeah.
My hand's down.
All right, good. Yeah. All right. So if there's no further discussion, we have a motion made and seconded to defer. And I guess the only thing that I would add to this is I think we want to be very specific about what information we believe that we need in order to make a final decision on this. So I guess what I've heard tonight is there needs to be further exploration about the property, the land itself, whether or not it is truly feasible to do what Mr. Michkowski has offered as a possibility for the fire station. We also need much more clarity on the actual bid from Mr. Greenbaum. And we need to get answers to some of the questions that were posed relative to if in fact the zoning, if he can obtain the variances he's looking for, what's the plan in that regard? And probably first and foremost, is he willing to move forward with a bid and carve out the lot, right?
Right.
And I'm sorry, and then obviously the cost-benefit discussion. We do need to put a price tag in front of us on what the carrying cost is for North Hadley Hall. Make sure that we're looking at that when we're looking at the decision whether or not to accept the bid. John?
Molly, I'm not speaking for the whole board, but I'm speaking as I sit as one member.
Planning board.
Yeah. I certainly, if that guy would step back and leave that portion or less, that I would work as hard as I could as a planning board to work with him. If he's going to put this capital outlay and preserve our building, I would do everything I could as the planning board to help him with this endeavor to make it back to there. And I think then the town would have the best of both worlds.
Okay.
The other thing I think people have to be aware of is the budget itself, the hypothetical situations that are trying to balance this budget. This is one of them. They already put $23,000 in the budget with the North Hadley Hall being sold as part of the process of balancing it. So now we have to come up with the $23,000 back into the budget if nothing happens with the sale.
Well, really? Again, not necessarily. Yeah. We just need to make sure.
It's look at our budget. It's in there, $23,000.
No, I agree with you. That's what I said. When we do the financial analysis, that all has to be taken into account. So yeah, I completely agree with you, Donald. I'm just saying there's not a foregone conclusion one way or the other either. So,
no.
But it's certainly a consideration. Okay.
Motion
made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay.
Good. Thank you.
We will defer to a soon-to-be-determined point in time when we have more information. Okay. Next on the agenda, we have the request for proposals to purchase property in Hadley. All right. So David, you want to cue this one up?
So we went out for request for proposals for purchase of 3 acres of land with the various criteria associated with it in terms of distance from the center of town, frontage, free of contamination, free of other kinds of restrictions such as conservation restrictions or APRs. We've received two proposals, one from
Dave, can you speak up a little bit?
Sure. So we received two proposals, one from the Bai family and one from Jones Realtors. The committee was put together to evaluate the two proposals. At this time, we have not opened the price proposals, so my understanding is that the committee met yesterday. Mm-hmm. And is there a ranking from that committee?
There is. Mr. Devine and I were both members of the committee, along with a handful of other individuals. And I guess the interesting thing is we went through the ranking process based on the criteria that were outlined in the RFP, obviously. But akin to the conversation we were just having, we had questions about the proposals that were actually submitted. So in going through that process, we ranked the Bai property first and the Jones property second. They were actually quite comparable with the exception of the fact that the Jones property did not meet the criteria to be within 3 miles of the town center. It's closer to 4 point something miles, I guess. However, with the Bai proposal, we had many questions because of the information that Mr. Bai submitted was very
unclear.
Unclear, yeah, very unclear. in terms of frontage. We're making an assumption it meets the frontage criteria, but we don't know that for a fact. And it was also unclear about the actual, he provided two maps. So we assumed that the map that we were looking at with the real estate bill attached is the property that we were evaluating, although there was another parcel outlined as well. So Mr. Nixon did try to reach Mr. Bai today, but that attempt was unsuccessful. All right, so yet again, we have a situation where we have proposals opened, but more information seems to be wanted.
So you have two options at this point. If you're comfortable with your ranking, then you're free to go forward and open up the price proposals and proceed from there, or you can take time and clarify the information that was submitted to you.
Pleasure of the board.
Let's open them up.
Prior to that, can I ask a question exactly where this Jones property is located?
The Jones property, I believe, is almost directly across from
the end of Stockbridge Road.
That's the parcel next to the McCretsky home.
Oh, okay. That's Jones. Jones is the realtor selling it for the
Hynotsky
property.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. That's a little better clarification. I thought it was some completely different location.
No, it's that. It's that. Yeah.
Another thing, you're mentioning Bai's property, but the Vakula property is before there and the town, isn't it?
Yes.
Which he owns 3/4 acre,
mm-hmm.
And you're not discussing his property at all. Without his property, it doesn't make any sense to Bai the other.
He didn't respond to the proposal.
So he doesn't want to sell it, in other words?
He didn't respond to the proposal.
It sort of makes the whole issue mute.
Willie?
Yes, I discussed a number of months ago with both Mr. Bai and Mr. Vakula on their properties. I don't know what price they came up with when they sent in their paperwork, but I discussed Mr. Bai, he was willing to sell his piece of property, but the price was astronomical. Mr. Vakula told us that he would sell 1 acre of land, which is considerable amount of money also. But Mr. Vakula said he didn't want to sell his. And if we bought Frankie Bai's, that is has the seniors, housing for the elderly on the back on one side, Mr. Vakula on this side, we can't get the Frankie Bai's property.
It's not clear whether or not the house is involved with
right.
the sale.
No, it's just the property.
Okay, but again, that's why we're looking for clarification,
yeah.
Willie. We
can
only react to what was put in front of us.
That's what he told me, and that's what I brought to the building committee before, and that was put aside only because neither house was involved in it. Mm-hmm. And the price was close to $500,000, so it didn't make much sense. We could Bai 10 acres of land for less money than we get Frankie Bai's property.
So
we looked at all those properties last year and had all this information, and we knew this was coming up, but to rank that as number one, you can't get to it.
Again, the ranking had to be conducive to the criteria that was included in the proposal, so we could only rank it to, that doesn't mean we can't contextualize it in all the rest of the story. Yeah.
I think you're going to be astonished what the prices are when you open those envelopes. Mr. Vakula spoke to me just on his 3/4 acre is $300,000 alone. Frank Bai was talking to me $2.1 million. So I'll be surprised what they are when you open them too. I can't believe it.
Rather than speculate, I guess Mr. Devine is suggesting we move forward to open the bids.
What's it gonna hurt? How did these two piece of properties in two different locations, we had two different RFPs out at one time, one for North Hadley and one for Centerville.
There's no RFP
there's
for North Hadley.
North Hadley is
North Hadley is a jewel property.
Has not gone out, though. The RFP for North Hadley has not gone out.
You just said it was the one that was on the end of Stockford.
We didn't, it was ranked, but we were looking, the criteria was for the center of town for 3 acres.
Oh.
Yep.
It was submitted, but it virtually didn't qualify.
So what's the pleasure of the board in terms of our next step?
I make a motion to open the bid, see what we're up against.
Was it a secret?
Okay. So we've got a motion made and seconded?
Second.
Any further discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. So what happens now, Mr. Nixon?
There goes.
Joyce, you would have hired it till it's open. Maybe it's Publishers Clearing House saying we won $5 million.
Okay, this is from Timothy Bai, and he said he'd like to extend to you the opportunity to buy the property, offering at a price of $475,000 per acre, totaling $1,425,000 for the total acreage.
$1 million what?
And this actually talks about 3 acres of land located at 40 Middle Street. So I think that supports Mr. Dan Lico's contention that the home is not included nor the frontage.
So that was $425,000.
Per acre.
Per acre.
Okay. And the Jones Realtor listing. Proposed purchase price from Brad Spry, representing Jones Group, is for $499,000.
For what? How many acres?
I think that was 5 acres, right?
Last time I knew it was for 3 building lots.
Closer to 10.
Nine, it's almost 10.
Right, yes, I'm sorry.
It was just the front.
9.7 acres.
Yeah, right, it was just under 10 acres.
Just under 10.
Reasonable price for that.
A little bit more reasonable. For sure.
Okay, so can I turn these over to you, Mr. Nixon?
Yes, indeed.
Madam Chairman?
Yes.
I got a comment.
Yes, sir.
I heard a lot of laughter about buys. But under the current zoning, it goes to the bike path. That is very possible he could get more because there could be a medical center there. They knocked the house down. That could be.
It's in the business zone.
Right?
Yeah.
So that's not funny that he couldn't get that kind of money.
Zoning commercial.
And another thing is, one more thing, before you buy anything, I would want to see a certified Massachusetts appraiser appraise the land. No one else picked numbers, as I hear, out of the sky, and tell these taxpayers and voters, this is the amount we need to without any kind of appraisal on it. Good investment.
All right, so does this now move to...
So typically what we do in this case, we take everything under advisement. We double check the arithmetic and make sure that there isn't any issue with the bid proposals at this time.
Yep.
And I can do that overnight, and we can have a recommendation to the board for your meeting at 6 o'clock tomorrow.
All right.
I think this is going to lead us to additional discussion when we talk about the warrant articles now, because this is impending on our decision. How we vote on those warrant articles now.
Right, it's new information.
Yes.
Yep.
Is this connected to one of the warrant articles for tomorrow?
Yes, it is.
Yeah. And what is the purpose of the land? Just refresh my memory. Why are we entertaining buying this particular land?
Right. I mean, it really came about as a result of the Municipal Building Committee and the conversation about the fact that the town really doesn't own that much land right now.
Okay, but what municipal purpose would it be put to?
Right.
My question.
Undetermined at this time.
But so potentially it could be anything. It could be a senior center. If all of a sudden the library needed to take that piece of property, or we voted tomorrow night to take the library and take down Hooker School, we need a place for a senior center. We have no land available at this point in time. If we were to need to facilitate and bring about a place for a senior center, Park and Rec, if we end up closing North Hadley Hall, if they need a place to go, we have no available resources in this town, any place to go with these things should these projects be pushed along. And that's the idea behind it. And it was brought about by the Buildings Committee, who said that we need to begin to understand if we're going to be bringing apart and facilitating some of these projects, we need alternatives as to where to go with other things that we're moving in town. This is a domino effect, and
so
we need it.
Just so I understand, you're buying this to inventory it for some possible future use.
How about the fire station?
I'm sorry.
North Hadley Fire Substation?
Right.
John.
Yeah, and
John, the town hall property. The town hall property where we're sitting right now. We have no property here.
We don't even have parking here. Russell School, minimal parking. The school owns all the way around it. The library has virtually no access. They're right to the end of their property with the handicap ramp. The senior center has quite a piece of property behind it. What we were looking for was to attach to the property we already own for a community center, a senior center, a library possibly, whatever the taxpayers vote for tomorrow night or don't vote for. But at some point, we don't own enough of land to expand anything.
If you guys want to recommend it to the people that are going to vote for it, every million will be an increase of about 9% of their taxes.
Yeah.
And I'm not contesting that. I just couldn't remember what it was we were buying the land for.
Point of interest, too, again?
Sure.
Mr. Waskevich, about 20 minutes ago, you were just saying 4 years in a row, we can't balance our budget.
I know.
No money to balance our budget.
I know.
Now, coming out of your mouth, you want to buy land. We're not in the real estate business in this town, believe me.
I think he was just explaining to, responding to a question.
I'm trying to explain the options we're up against right now. Do we get historical money and CPA money and spend twice as much on the library to rehab it, or North Hadley Hall, or the town hall for that matter? These are all still viable options, just like North Hadley Hall and a new fire station on the property.
They're all viable, but I honestly believe we have to get our financial house in order before we do anything.
Yeah.
Mr. Danlicka, something
briefly?
We're
still just talking in circles, and until the people give us a little bit more direction on which way we should go, exactly. I'm not going
to
make that.
I'd like to tell you where to go.
Wait.
Oh, you've already told me where to go, John.
All right,
thank you.
A little humor from the back there.
When are you going to hit that?
Mr. Danlicka?
Yeah.
On that second request for proposals there, from Brad D.H. Jones, that piece, that price was given for the property in North Hadley that we're talking about, mm-hmm. the 10 acres. And the reason he sent that in, because we discussed it, and that's the $500,000 that we were looking for land. The reason he sent that in was just to make sure that town knew that they were willing to sell that property, because there was a piece, there was some question prior about the price of that piece of land, and it was a little very expensive. Mm-hmm. So now it's down, and it's, I mean, it's 9+ acres, and it's $500,000. It's what is he bid on that property, and he sent that in not for something in the center of town. It's strictly that piece of property there was what that second bid was.
Right, understood.
And I talked to him a number of times about this setup. So, and that is four building lots. It is sectioned off right now for four building lots, mm-hmm. but
it's in 61A,
not APR. And he's just waiting for our approval to approval or disapproval, and 61A is coming off pretty soon. So,
is there four building lots on the front?
Yeah.
Frontage?
In front of Chuck. Yeah.
Okay, final comment, and then we
can
move on.
Madam Chairman, what I always thought you folks did, the select board, is set that building committee on a mission to assess buildings and come up with a priority list to the board of selectmen. Instead of putting the library, senior center, everybody in a panic mode running around, I have never heard about the priority list, what is most important to the citizens of the town. And I really think that should be decided right there. What's the cost of repairing? What is our priority list? And go from there and just say to the people, said, look, is this your priority? If the library's on top, fine. If the senior center's on top, fine. But nothing else, public safety, DPW, that everybody needs. Like I asked you about infrastructure, there's a multi-million dollar project there sitting. Where's that money gonna come from?
And to your point, I mean, you know, it...
Set a priority.
It would be nirvana if we were fully through a planning process, but we have, you know, a situation in life where things are coming up, where decisions need to be made, and we haven't fully completed the plan.
Not one of them are going to drop off the map. Not one of them. So you're doing something that's very important for the future of this town. I hope the heck you guys do it right and not make mistakes, learn from the mistakes that were made in the past so we don't fall and make those same mistakes. Not everybody in a panic mode.
Right.
Take your time and do something good for this community, all you guys.
And in the spirit of that, we'll discuss this not tonight, but tomorrow night. All right, once David, right, you'll do your thing and then we'll have further discussion on this tomorrow night. Okay. Okay. Town meeting warrants next on the agenda.
Well, why are we doing this again? Are we doing this tomorrow night before the meeting?
I believe that there was a question whether or not there was some additional information on certain warrant articles. So whether it made sense for us to discuss those.
I think it was part of my request, Madam Chair. I felt that being a new member on the board, going to town meeting with votes that were taken by a member that is no longer here isn't proper, and we should re-vote. If all your votes remain the same, that's no problem. But I should have an opportunity to put my vote in there to see what transpires with it. It may change some of the votes from the board, it may not. But I think the problematic ones, I should have the opportunity to cast a vote.
So I was just thinking about this, and I'll just my two cents, and then ask for the opinion of the board. You know, on the one hand, you can make an argument that select board member who sat through the majority of the fiscal year where that this town meeting is the culmination of had, you know, more information than somebody coming new on a board just because of the way our election cycle falls. I was just thinking back, I believe in the past, I know when I started on the board, we didn't re-vote anything, so to the extent votes were already taken,
right,
to the extent they stood, but certainly anybody at town meeting has the opportunity to be recognized by the moderator and speak if they have a different opinion, and I think I actually may have done that on one article my first year. So having said that, to the extent there are any particular articles, maybe specifically like this building one or whatever, where there's new information that's different from the information that was in front of us when we did take the original vote, that may be worth putting up for a revote. So that's just the way I'm looking at it. So
I felt the same way, that didn't change it either when I came on board many years ago either, that, you know, it was the person before that had voted on it. And you did have the opportunity at town meeting to interject your opinion also if it was different from what was there.
John, Jerry?
Yeah, no, I was thrown in the same way 3 years ago too. It stood, and anything I had asked on town meeting floor, I believe, too.
Okay.
Motion.
Mr. Michkowski.
Another point of interest. It's been changing weekly for the last month and a half with the Finance Committee. This board voted before we even seen any of the recommendations of the Finance Committee. Most of the Finance Committee recommendations are completely opposite of what the board voted, because they voted prematurely because they didn't have all the information. Now there's new information that has come on board. Your vote would change if you put the new information in, I think, and consider it again. You're voting on something that happened 3 months ago.
But are there specific articles, is what I'm asking, Donald, that you...
Yes, the land articles we just talked about is one of them. The library is another issue we should consider.
I'm not sure that there's any new information on the library. The land, I can see. The one that we just opened the bids. John?
Madam Chairman, I think it's really disgusting to listen to what's happening here. A sitting selectman that probably did a lot of research before he became a selectman, and things have changed and updated, and it's exactly, you can keep your vote the same. What is the harm of listening to what his vote is? What is the harm?
There's no denying he has the opportunity.
He's a sitting selectman. give him the opportunity to vote.
So
don't be like that. Cut it out. They tell me that all the time.
So,
I'm giving it back
again,
to
what's
them.
The pleasure?
Stop running our meeting, John. We don't run your meeting.
That's all right.
No, I'm just telling you the truth. That's okay. The difference.
So, again, we're just talking about past practice. I don't have an appetite to change past practice. I don't think that it warrants it.
Where's the policy?
Excuse me. To the extent that there's a particular article, and I would argue certainly that the one that we're just talking about, actually tomorrow night would seem to be the time to revote that, because that's when David is going to update the figures.
Right, so what I'll do is I'll just make sure that the bids are, that there's nothing wrong with the bid, that there's no challenge or anything like that. So just take 24 hours on that particular one and we'll be clear.
Point of interest question, sure. Again. Tomorrow we have a meeting scheduled for 6 o'clock,
mm-hmm.
as the board.
Yep.
So at that time, if it behooves us our best interest, we could vote then to change them with the land?
Yeah, do that. That's what I'm suggesting.
Want.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is that
Well, I would like you to pull out the pertinent articles that we would be considering. If those two articles are the only one, I would know that. So then I'm going to have to take a different avenue and speak at town meeting as an individual selectman, not the board.
Sure.
Which I will do, but I would hope we would pull the other problematic articles also and discuss them at 6 o'clock tomorrow.
Okay.
In the last couple of years, Donald, what we've done was if we ran into a conflict like this, then tomorrow night at 6 o'clock, we would just recommend to pass over that article with the moderator. That's the way we did it. I know it's, I understand it's last minute, but you get this information that you just opened up tonight that we've got to make a decision on at 6 o'clock tomorrow night before we present it to the people,
mm-hmm.
then we need to pass over until we get more information. It's
well, it's going to be a very lively meeting. There's many other things. The
millions of dollars.
The grease traps.
That.
We got to, that's going to be a lively thing. The backhoe is going to be a lively thing if we're taking the money legally. So I just want to eliminate those problems prior to going to town meeting.
Sure.
Because town meeting is going to become a fiasco.
So,
and I don't want that to happen.
So Donald, actually, can I approach it a different way?
We'd have all afternoon to do it.
if I could just ask it a different way.
Sure.
Rather than me presupposing what the problematic articles are, you're seeing the votes that were taken before, so you know the ones that you're interested in challenging.
Mm-hmm.
So if you wouldn't mind, could you go through and just clue me into which articles those
I'll
are?
I'll sit with David first thing in the morning.
Oh,
I'll be
okay.
And he'll give to you email or whatever.
Are we meeting tomorrow morning?
Yeah, we'll coordinate our schedule, so we'll meet with the chair and then we'll all be with you.
Okay.
I'm going to meet with the fire chief and police chief at 9 o'clock tomorrow.
All right.
So
have to be
I'll
after
be in
that.
After maybe 10 o'clock,
I'll
be
in touch myself.
Okay, fine.
All right. Is that everybody agreeable to that?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay, great. Excellent. So we're now.
Could I just ask a question? So tomorrow night, 6 o'clock, other warrant articles will be open for a revote possibly if the board chooses to do so?
Yeah, you're right. We're not reopening the warrant, but to the extent that this
our recommendations.
Right. Just, yeah. It's just a recommendation. So I think that this North Hadley land, that particular one, makes sense
right,
to me.
Right, because there's new information. And when it was brought up about the library, I don't believe we have any new information since your vote. So.
I don't believe there's any new information on the library. Right. But
there sort of new information, if we propose to knock down the Hooker School, where do we put Council on Aging if we don't get any additional land? So it is part of the equation.
I disagree, and I think there's still time to deal with that. So that's really not different from the conversation we had before. But at any rate, so yes, Karen, that's the plan. Okay. Pardon? Oh yeah, it's an open meeting. It's
right.
Posted.
No,
so that you're welcome
here
for that
in case
well.
There's questions in regards to the land and the possibilities, but that's part of what I think Article 11 is to, you know, get an OPM to explore what the possibilities are for land, whether it's the field behind, or new purchases, or a building to be renovated, that's what Article 11 is.
Right, that'll be part of the talking points for that article. Okay? All right, so I think we have concluded old business, and we're moving on to new business. Next item?
Point of order?
Yes, sir.
About an hour and 31 minutes ago, I asked for an explanation of the shortfall and the push-offs to the fall and the sources of revenue.
You're right, yes.
And I'm hoping to get that. I've waited patiently.
Okay.
I'm interested in what you all had to say. And two of your members have brought up the finances.
Okay. Just going to try to condense it, and just in the spirit of time, but very briefly, when the budget moved to the Finance Committee, they were looking at a shortfall of in the neighborhood of just under $500,000, right? 400 and some out, or $500,000. Okay, so that was taking into account everything that the departments had put down for level services, contractual obligations, etc.
Well, their requests, in other words.
Pardon?
Their requests.
No, we actually, in the budget process, we had level services, and then off to the side, we had what we referred to as enhanced programming and services. So that was really what they were requesting, was the bar column. As part of the Finance Committee's review of the budget, and David participated in that, and several department heads and select board members attended those meetings, the recommendation of the Finance Committee to bring that gap down as close to zero as possible was to defer the funding of OPEB, to defer the funding...
For how much?
251,000.
Okay.
And that's why I can get you more specific numbers, John, but just...
Well, it's not for me, it's for the public.
I know, I'm just saying, here's a thumbnail sketch. $250,000, which was about half of that shortfall. Well, the recommendation was to defer that to fall town meeting. There were also COLA increases for municipal employees, $15,000 and change. Recommendation was to defer that decision to fall town meeting. Obviously, as you know, predicated on the availability of free cash. The schools agreed to accept $75,000 less in funding, and that $75,000 of their request would be deferred to fall town meeting. That's the lion's share of it. Then there were a handful of other items that were additions, agreement to increase revenue slightly, and then $2,000 here, $1,000 there for some other expense items. Again, I just don't have all that detail in front of me, but that covers the bulk of it. Ultimately, getting down to about $140,000 that the Finance Committee couldn't determine exactly how that gap would be closed. So the recommendation going to town meeting is that full court press will be on going into the fiscal year to identify the means to cover that $140,000 shortfall. Okay, and the Finance Committee will be speaking to that at town meeting.
Okay, so when I add, just so to see if I understand it, for anyone else who may be interested, that adds up to about $480,000 if I take the 140 plus the items that you've enumerated.
Right, and as I said, there are other items making up that difference.
A couple thousand dollars here.
Yep.
I'm just speaking. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, what happens to the 100, how does the 140 we're short get covered?
Right, so the select board will be talking more about this with the Finance Committee. It'll probably be the major topic of conversation at our first tri-board meeting. We're at a point that we need to obviously bridge that gap. There are only a finite number of ways to do it. We either need to find additional sources of revenue. We need to decrease cost either through efficiency or a reduction in services, because we're at that point, or a combination of the two. So going into the fiscal year, that is going to be the major priority of this board in concert with the Finance Committee and the department heads to work collectively to figure this out.
One area that you left out is probably one of my most important areas, that we're deferring, and I don't like doing that at all. It's deferring the money from the fire department from 90,000 to 50, which is 40,000 to the fall town meeting. My number one priority is fire and safety and protection of the town's property. There's no way around seconding it with anything.
Are you, I think it's the police department.
No, it's the fire department, I believe. Is it yours?
No.
The police department is 49,000.
Okay, so then.
And that was the adding of the extra officers, and they've deferred that. We had 3 officers additional this year. They've agreed to defer that until a later date, so it's not an arbitrary number. It is a finite number.
And secondly, the problematic thing I have is by deferring everything to the fall town meeting, we go from May to late fall, and we're hoping that our free cash escalates to 500,000. All my number crunching doesn't even get us close to that. It's maybe, I think, 300. So we're another 200 short. But my main concern is the interim. If the town has any outstanding liability during that interim, the Department of Revenue will pull whatever we have in free cash to cover that liability. And that means, again, we have to go back and cover that. I talked to the chairman of the Finance Committee, and his answer to all of this shortfall in the end is something I despise, and it shouldn't be done, is taking the money from stabilization to offset the operating budget.
Okay. So that's to Donald's point, there are going to be a variety of opportunities for people to pitch in, roll up their sleeves, and get creative. Okay. The reality is, coming up to town meeting, there is no definitive answer. And to your point, rather than make a knee-jerk reaction and quite frankly do some of what has been done in the past, which is to be a little bit arbitrary in cutting departmental budgets, we collectively made the determination that that was not the way to approach this, that we need to buy additional time, and we're going to ask for the full faith and confidence of town meeting to support us in helping us get that done, because ultimately town meeting and the taxpayers are going to have to make some final determinations on what services they're willing to pay for. I agree with Donald. Several of us have articulated a concern about where we stand with public safety. We do deem that to be a major priority. Something's got to give. So
can you stop right there?
Yeah.
He mentioned, I think, 49,000 for police.
That was an enhancement to the police chief's payroll.
Okay, yep. But that isn't in this budget.
Correct.
The numbers you just gave me.
Correct. That is not in there.
So to 480, should I add 49,000?
No. There's the level services budget, and then there are the additional requests from the departments. So I think what you're hearing is that we firmly want to consider meeting some of those requests for additional services. Okay.
So
that has to be factored in.
I should draw another line and say, in addition to the 480, you're looking to produce additional services, lease costing maybe 49,000.
Correct.
So that's in addition.
That's in addition. Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Now, and I hate to.
Okay, we're running out of time here, John.
Well, how can we be running out of time? This is, the public is going to vote on this. Where is the revenue expected to come from?
I think you didn't hear me clearly. I said we have to look at revenue. We also have to look at expense. So don't presume an outcome. We have to be dealing with both.
So in other words, these may be cut between now and the fall.
That's very possible. Okay. Because we need to bring this back to the residents of the town and have them help us. I don't want to presume what you think is the most important thing. But we need to frame it in a meaningful way so it's not a free-for-all. I don't believe in menu voting.
The public is going to determine priority.
Yeah, exactly. But in the last 3 years I've been on this board, we've been shortfalling ourselves on the revenue side. We've been overestimating our revenue. And at fall town meeting, when we get the certified money in, we're spending it. And that money in October for the fall meeting is really for next year's budget, not the present year's budget that we're falling behind in.
Mr. Ruskovich, that's why I'm bringing it up.
Right.
Because the next step is...
These are all points I brought up, and I've got voted down on it, John. And they're all coming true, and we've been through the tri-board meeting and everything else with it.
Okay, so
we're not going to resolve it tonight. And again, the good news is everybody up here is 20% of this body's voting power. So we will be addressing it over the next several months. We can't be going into fall town meeting kicking this can to the following spring, and everybody recognizes that.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, final comment?
Yep. Article 12, $30,000 for the school for grease traps out of sewer reserves.
Yes.
I absolutely just can't stand that to happen. Our infrastructure is so in need of repairs and improvements that this should not be.
I have it recommended to come off tomorrow, John, in our 6 o'clock meeting.
You do?
I do.
I thank you for that. Now, as we go down here, the backhoe, $150,000. The $100,000 is going to be a debt exclusion?
Yep.
Then can I ask why you're not going for the whole thing?
The last time that we put it on there, it was voted down. It was voted down for the $150,000.
I voted down, my wife voted down. They lost by 2 votes. Had they...
Because of you, then.
I'm glad, too.
Because of you.
No, I want to tell you how you can learn by your mistakes. Had that been proposed, and the factor of the repairs, I went down there...
I think Marla will do a wonderful job on town meeting floor and is ready to bring his article that thick to talk to it tomorrow.
$25,000 out of reserve account to buy a backhoe.
We were listening to the taxpayers.
Borrow the whole thing.
John, you have the opportunity to speak to that at town meeting, but again, we want to let the DPW director speak to the article first.
But you guys did this, not him.
Okay. All right, so we're moving on now to the lease agreement for Russell School.
So good news, we have some revenue coming in.
Yes.
Oh boy.
Okay, so the contractor for the Route 9 widening is looking for office space. They want to get away from the past practice of using mobile trailers for their office space. They would like to rent space from the Russell building, about 500 square feet. They're offering a lease of $9,600 per year, the rate of $800 a month. They'll be taking care of the utilities, and the money will be placed in a revolving fund for the operation and maintenance of the building, except for the first final rent, which we received in FY16, which will go to the general fund.
So they'll pay for heating and electricity?
Yep. So I recommend that we sign this lease agreement.
So moved.
Second.
Point of interest.
Mm-hmm.
There's also another phase to this that we're not talking about. They're also using the property that the town owns above the Legion as a staging area for all of their equipment. And I feel the $800 isn't sufficient when we're giving them that amount of land and the building. I would like to see it increased at least to $1,000.
Try doubling it, then you'll be in a ballpark.
Okay, are you making an amendment to the motion, or are you?
So we're talking about the Russell School building right now, not the...
Oh, not the, yeah.
Not the
staging area separate.
The staging area, we're gonna handle that separately. So.
Okay.
Okay, I don't have a problem with the Russell School at 800. I would like to see it more, but after talking to the administrator, I understand they only have one room over there, basically. They're not renting the whole building, so we still have the opportunity to rent the rest of the building if we choose to do so.
Okay.
Gary Berg's negotiated this with the vendor, and I think it already includes using the Legion area as well. There's some advantages to the town regarding a stub being put out here and other things that the contractor is going to be working with us as well. I think in the spirit of the contract being negotiated, we should go forward with the recommendation we have before us.
What's he doing extra, Jerry?
Putting our stub in so that we can drain the water that comes off the roof here, and where we're having a big problem with a drainage problem out in the middle of our parking lot here, and some water migrating back in here.
he's putting the stub in there, and with our new backhoe, Marlo and his crew is going to be able to tie it into the drain over there. There's another article on town meeting floor of $60,000 for our town hall to mitigate the problem in the parking lot, and I'll be talking about taking that off as well tomorrow, because they're going to be able to help us with the mitigation.
Good idea.
Did you have a question or comment?
Is there a liability issue with them using a building we own and their equipment?
That's covered by their liability, their certificate of insurance associated with this project, which is on file.
Okay, so motion made and seconded.
I guess I have another question. What entitled Gary Berg to do the negotiation to the board? I thought the administrator was involved in that, not just Gary Berg.
Mr. Berg worked closely with me and checked in with me, so there's a lot of communication between us.
And I think that's because Mr. Berg did most of the work over that was requested and was intricately involved into what the needs were over there to get done.
So the board didn't have any firsthand knowledge until tonight of what transpired?
No, we knew what was going on throughout this whole, it was before the DPW director was even hired.
I just wanted to make sure the board was aware of what transpired, if you were satisfied with it.
And I remember talking with the chair about this when we first heard about this.
Okay,
so motion made and seconded, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Great. Public safety complex roof.
We've received a recommendation from the municipal building committee that the bid specifications for the roof replacement on the public safety complex are now ready for bid. As it's our past practice, we always bring this to the board before developing the invitation for bids and advertising it.
Any big changes?
We have $150,000 set aside for this project, and there's additional funding requested if we on the annual town meeting warrant.
For $55,000 more. Motion accept.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Great. Okay, then the last regular agenda item before we move to executive session, Select Board Code of Conduct. David, you want to cue this one up?
Sure. Many boards of selectmen across the Commonwealth adopt a code of conduct in order to promote productivity, predictability of the work, and to promote the prosperity of the community in general by focusing strictly on the business at hand, conducting business in a professional manner, so many towns adopted this. Just as a side note, the town managers, town administrators across the Commonwealth have subscribed to a code of ethics promulgated by the International City County Managers Association. We find it very helpful to have a touchstone so that we can practice our profession in an ethical and orderly manner. We think that enhances our ability to work with communities. So I was asked to do a little bit of research and found a model from the town of Princeton, Massachusetts, which is before you. Obviously, you're probably going to take this under consideration for tonight and adopt this at some later time, but I do recommend that we consider seriously a code of conduct for the select board.
So what I'd like to do is ask everybody on the board to read those bullets carefully. I did ask David to do some research. He showed me several examples. To be honest with you, they're not identical. The town of Granby was like 28 pages long for some reason, which makes me wonder about what conduct they needed to code. But most of the municipalities were pretty identical. So if everybody could read through these bullets, and if you have any questions or concerns, bring them to that. I'd like to have it actually on the next meeting agenda if we can. So if there's anything you find problematic, if you think needs to be added, by all means.
Is there other ones that we could get? Could you just email us the other ones that you had a chance to pull up?
Yeah,
please.
Yep.
And I guess my question is, how does this differ from the code of ethics that we have to adhere to already?
Yeah, sworn board members.
Yeah, the code of ethics is very specific in terms of, I mean, it's really to help one determine what's ethical and unethical behavior. And ethics, I mean, but the first kind of thing you think about is, are you doing anything that's basically you're benefiting from the action you're taking to the potential detriment of others, or you're not being above board, or that kind of thing. The code of conduct really has to do with communication, behavior, how we interact with department heads, chain of command issues, and the like. So I think when you read through the bullets, Donald, you'll see that there's some overlap, certainly. There is an ethical component to this, but it's not strictly that narrow a focus.
Well, I feel the ruling body on that is the voters. If we step out of line, we won't be sitting here very long, believe me. They have the final choice.
There's a communication effort as well.
And if we can't act respectively to each other in the public, then we have a personal problem, and we shouldn't even be sitting here.
Yeah.
Well, I think too, it just makes us more aware that we need to tend to be more respectful to one another as a board, and to also not tread on other, you know, we all have our boards and things that we are
responsible
for, and I have continuous meetings with the fire chief and the police chief, and if anybody has any problems or anything going on with them, I would certainly like to be notified and talk it over with them and bring it back to the board, as I have done in the past.
When it was pointed out to me that I spoke to the police chief,
we have liaisons. Those are the people that are supposed to be speaking to those individual departments.
But at any time, any board member can speak with any department head.
I guess that's part of what this is about.
Let's read through this. I mean, I really do think we just need to, I mean, to be honest with you, it's a professionalizing what most of us are already doing anyway. I don't think that it's codifying it. It's articulating it and saying that we recognize that this is how we're supposed to behave, and I think there's a power to that, you know, reading it, acknowledging it, and saying, yep, that's what I'm supposed to be doing.
I guess I want to clarify, Jen, to Joyce, why I'm meeting with the fire and police chief tomorrow morning. They're just walking me through the building for 15 minutes to tell me about all the infrastructure that was done. I'm not aware of it. They want to tell me about the roof. Nothing to do with departmental procedures. Mm-hmm. It's all concerning the building. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Yeah, sure. No, I did the same thing when
I was in. I think that's a great thing for you to do, too.
Thank you.
To do that. You know, just coming on board and seeing what's there.
Is this pertaining
to
the select board?
Yeah. Absolutely.
That's what I wanted.
I know that the school committee, when I was on school committee, there was a code of conduct that the school committee adopted as well. And actually, to that point, I would recommend that this be adopted by any elected board. I would encourage the planning board, if you don't have one already, to consider one.
But you're not mandating it.
No. Oh, no, we can't mandate it.
You're not mandating it.
What I would suggest, if you're going to adopt something, invite everyone that's concerned about this and ask their input before you adopt it.
No, this is basically for the Board of Selectmen.
Yeah.
This has nothing to do with other elected officials.
It said select board and other elected officials, what I read.
But this is for us. This is for us to follow.
Right.
If you would like to follow it.
Then why did you put other elected officials on it?
Well, Johnny, it also says Town of Princeton on it. So this was just
and we're not in Princeton anymore.
Yeah, we're not
anymore,
Princeton.
John.
This was just an example of what the Town of Princeton did.
I hope you realize that.
We're only Amherst College and Mass.
Okay, John?
I'd just like to point out that there's a wonderful book over at the Goodwin Memorial Library. It's put out by the ICMA that was just mentioned.
Yeah.
And it talks about, it's almost like a textbook, how towns should be managed. Mm-hmm. And there's a great section in there about codes of conduct and why they're important. So if any of your board members want to skim through it.
So you're congratulating us to be on the cutting edge, John? That's where we're going? You're congratulating us for being on the cutting edge?
No, you guys are so far behind. I had to get the library to buy the book. I don't think there's one in the town hall.
All right.
I'll make a motion that we take this under advisement and have a vote at a future time.
Okay, second on that
motion?
Yeah,
I'll second it.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
All right, thank you. So before we move into executive session, do we have any announcements this evening?
Okay, got a couple.
Joyce?
I gotta be careful with my, too.
Who's got the first one? Who's got the first one? Well, do you have the best one?
I have it right here.
Okay.
Ron Breska is a past teacher at Hopkins Academy, and well-known around town. He is in Phoenix, Arizona with his wife, Mary Ann. Ron was diagnosed with ALS about a year ago, a year and a half ago. And there is going to be a tribute at the Young Men's Club, June 12th. It's a fundraiser. Appetizers at 1 o'clock, opening ceremony at 1:30, barbecue 2 to 4, live music, afternoon and early evening. Please buy tickets in advance. Make checks payable to Ron Breska ALS Fund. Donation is $20. Maybe we can get this on the website too, if you would mind, on HPAP.
Already on HPAP.
Great, thank you.
Thanks, Richard.
So just to let you know that Ron is still with us, and we'd like people to come out and honor him. He was our baseball coach for many years also at Hopkins Academy, which we dedicated the field over there to him when he retired. And just come out and have a good time.
Can I add something to that?
Sure.
Ken has asked me to MC the event, which I consider an honor. They're my next door neighbors. I grew up to him. I looked at Ron as like an idol growing up. He did everything I wanted to do in life, and I try to exemplify what he did. He was just a great role model, and I feel honored to do this for the family.
That's great.
Nice. Yeah. Then I have
Wait, hang on. Just something about that particular announcement?
No.
Okay, hang on.
He's my cousin.
You're related to everybody.
He was my gym teacher for a couple
you're
of
Polish,
years.
You're related to everybody.
He's my, no, is he your cousin? No,
no,
my cousin.
That's what I said. You're related to everybody.
Damn right I am.
Yes.
And Joyce,
George,
another?
Too, wasn't it? George,
any more announcements?
Any more announcements, Joyce?
Yes.
I got one.
I have to the family of Sophie Morawski. We send our condolences to them. She's a longtime realtor here in town. Mm-hmm. And 94 years old.
Yeah.
Quite the lady.
Quite a stitch. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. And then we also have condolences to the family of, help me if I mispronounce this, Louis Malbouf. He is the uncle of Terry Yushko and Marianne Zerinsky, and I believe his sister lives here in town, Mrs. Buda. Mm-hmm. So our condolences to them, too.
Any other announcements here on the board before we go to the audience?
I would just like to re-announce, we did it the other day, but our first annual Hadley Cleanup, sponsored by the Select Board, is taking place this Saturday. We're going to meet at Hopkins Academy at 9 o'clock. We'll have a breakfast. We'll provide water. We'll provide all the utensils and bags that you need to clean up. After we finish the cleanup, we'll come back to Hopkins Academy and we'll have a light lunch. So we're looking for any volunteers that want to show up. And also, the Park and Rec is doing a cleanup of Zaterka Park at the same time. I didn't know about it. So they're looking for some volunteers, possibly, if we have extra at ours, to send them that way if they want to go there. But we'd appreciate, we'll announce this at town meeting also. Thank you.
John?
Yeah, I got an announcement from Miss Molly. I think she did a superb job running the meeting, changing basic attitudes, getting people involved, and I like it. I may not have to run against you when you come up for re-election.
Oh, Jesus.
Bring
this
it.
This was a paid political ad.
Thank you, Mr. Richkowski.
Here, let's bless you.
Okay,
now.
Yeah, really. David?
Just to make the announcement again that town meeting is tomorrow at 7 o'clock at Hopkins Academy.
Oh, and I would like to make
parade?
No, I don't do the parade. I think that we should televise it tomorrow night. I think that we should have people come to town meeting instead of sitting home watching it on TV. I would like to see town meeting not televised, and I would like to see more people there. and it could be televised next week so they could see what happened. But I think we have a lot of important issues on the agenda for them to come out. Anybody else feel that way? I make a motion for that to happen.
Already in the schedule.
Well, it could be canceled.
We had that for candidates night. It was supposed to be live, and you forgot to plug the plug in, so it wasn't live. So things can be changed.
Right.
But that's my.
You don't have to worry. Tomorrow will be packed.
Yeah. The only concern I have is that there, and I know the senior center's been great about offering people rides.
Yeah.
But I do worry about the people who can't make it to town meeting.
You're still going to see it.
Yeah, I know.
Not like that at all. But that really.
I don't think the night before is the time to make that recommendation. If you want to make the recommendation, you know, get it so that you can get some public input on it, so.
And maybe make it for future town meetings.
Are you making a motion on that? If you make the motion, I will second it.
Move it.
I second the motion.
Point of order.
Post it already.
I don't know if that's a legal motion. I think under open meeting law that people have a right to record it, and I think that if they want to broadcast it, they have that right. I just don't think that this is, I understand what you're trying to do, but I just don't think that this one is a proper motion.
But you're using you think, you don't know. That's the difference.
How about if we discuss it further
tomorrow
night?
For further discussion. Why don't we let it go and further discussion?
I think you need to check in with council on that.
Okay, all right, let's do that.
I'll give you that. If we don't have a good turnout tomorrow night, I will make a motion on another time for that to happen.
Okay, yeah, I think it's good.
Little houses will fill the house.
Withdraw your motion, okay.
I'll withdraw my second.
If you don't like that, go live in a tiny house.
Okay, so executive session, would somebody like to make a motion that we enter into? You have to look there for the content, though.
For what reason?
To discuss strategy with respect to litigation if an open meeting may have detrimental effect on the litigation position of the public body, and the chair so declares. Five Colleges, Inc. versus Town of Hadley.
There's a second one as well.
And the second one is
DPW
to
litigation.
Discuss the DPW union.
And not to reconvene.
Not to reconvene in open session.
Okay, so there's a motion on the floor. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, as chair of the Hadley Select Board, I state that the board has moved and seconded to enter into executive session, and that I state that discussing the matter in open session will have an adverse effect on the town of Hadley.
Roll call vote. Luskevitz?
Yes.
Devine?
Yay.
Keegan?
Yes.
Chunglo?
Yes.
Kaczynski?
Yay.
Amanda?